Sorry. What is the word? What does it mean? I mean, Mother Nature doesn't care about relationships. She just wants you to breed. She just wants you to lay those eggs and then you could drop dead for all she cares. I mean, and this is just a complication with the human race. I mean, think of a cow, right? A cow just stands there in a field. A bull comes along, does a little cha-cha action on her back. And voila, a relationship. You know, they don't care what each other's star sign is or whether they both like veal parmesan, they just do it. And who you do it with depends on where in the past you're standing. That's all. It's all simple. You know, all the money women spend, I spend, you know, on getting the right lipstick to match right, nail polish to match right, hat to match right, shoes. Wouldn't it be fantastic? You just stand in a field on all fours. Then a bull comes along, you go, yeah, time to mate, okay. Finished? Good, then I can get back to shopping. You know, we could learn so much from Mother Nature. We could learn so much from the spider kingdom. They have it even better than the cow. You just find a mate, have sex with him, then kill him. Finished. Anyway, I'm sick of my own voice. So I'm going to introduce you to somebody now who, if I was a cow, I would have cha-cha action with. Please welcome Eddie Izzard.
Fruit.
I like the fruit.
All right.
I do this thing with fruit. I think a lot of people do this, where you go in the supermarket, you buy a load of fruit, you go, I'll get that, because vitamin C, vitamin E, vitamin L, vitamin N, vitamins, you way down the end of the alphabet, and you get them all, and you get them a big pile, and then you watch them rot.
It's true. They go to those little kind of tiny little
scrotum. Yeah, and you think, you go and say, they're all dead now. Oh. And you find some at the bottom that have got the green stuff on, and you just wait until it grows quite big and then
melt
collapses.
Down,
yeah.
Get into a tiny
and then you throw away and you get another lot, and you come back and you set them all up nicely.
Is health a thing for you? Are you a health person?
Well, I try and cruise towards the health area.
That's enough.
Yeah, I don't really hit it much, yeah. You know. I just sort of wave as I go by.
To the healthy food.
Well, I eat some healthy food, then I go eat some complete crap later, and then it sort of, and die.
And who do you think, like, of the animal kingdom, going back, whirling your mind back to have a better, you know, have a better break than, like, the human race? Because I think we're built with flaws.
Well, we do. We have this relationship thing. The animals, they don't seem to go into big relationship stuff. We have thumbs, don't we?
Yeah, and is that the scroll?
They don't use thumbs, so therefore they don't have relationships. I'm sure there's a tie in there. You need thumbs to have, otherwise you can't grab hold of people. Say, come on! Come on, it's a relationship.
So with this, you just hit them and
you scroll. Just sort of, yeah, slap yeah. them about a bit, and you do that thing with the tigers do, where the claws come out. They go chung, and then they go back. And that's quite, you know, James Bond couldn't do that, could he? You know, chung.
Oh, that's how you get a woman? You just go chung and skewer and then bring her back?
I don't know, actually. Perhaps they just do that just for show and say, look, fingernails.
Oh, that's a kind of like the showing thing.
It's retractable. It's like the Aston Martin James Bond retractable fingernails. I mean, it's big in the tiger world.
I don't know.
Are you not happy on the stool? Do you want to move?
No, well, we could.
Is there another area that makes you feel more...
I have never done any of this. We could wander around, we could do this, it's kind of freaky. Show me the place.
I'll show you. Well, where you'd like to put your little bottom.
Well, we're going to have a look around here. Are these real?
These are real, everything is real. We're just going to find where he's comfortable, because he's never done this. What do you think here? Do you like the desk? Nothing works.
Yep. That's okay, kind of good.
Oh,
what, we're sitting here? Yeah.
Try it out if you don't like it.
I could do that.
This is more serious interview area. This is a more kind of like, you know, questions about how'd you get into comedy kind of a chair.
Well,
yeah. So now you can go and I can go make lunch.
Are you really asking me how I got into comedy?
I'm asking you.
Oh, well, actually, I was 7. I saw a play and I thought, oh, I want to do acting. I was a jailer. This is my big break. Well, this is when I was 15. Did Comedy of Errors. And I'm trying to sit in this properly. I did Comedy of Errors, the Shakespeare play, because Shakespeare writes such good comedies. All comedians hate Shakespeare comedies because there's no jokes in them. Basically, you know, like Midsummer Night's Dream, and the mechanical's going, oh, and all the lords and ladies go, oh, is that so funny? And we go, no, I don't think so. But Comedy of Errors has got a joke in it, one or two. And, I was the jailer in that, and I carried a spear quite a lot of the time.
Because you'd look good in that little outfit, you know, that little armor outfit.
Yeah?
You know that little skirt that they wear?
I do look good in short skirts.
I have.
And so did Romans. And that's why the Romans were.
I'm not segueing anywhere.
No, you're going into transvestism. Well,
I wasn't talking about transvestism.
Well, I was.
All right, well, you can discuss it.
No, just I happen to be a transvestite, and a lot of people are very jealous about it.
Very few people can segue from Roman soldiers to transvestites, but we just did, and I think that really... You can clap now. Thank you. That was a very good segue. It's okay. Well,
your audience applauses segues?
I'm so proud that I came up with that little leap in reality.
You know this? You're applauding segues? You have a segue time! Audience go mad.
Oh, so you were saying.
Okay, transvestism and space travel. Pretty good segue.
I feel you there. Are people upset that you... I mean, because if you're a transvestite, you dress like a woman.
No, I'm not a transvestite. But no one can deal with this idea because you're wearing trousers, you're wearing leggings, you wear a jacket. Women have total clothing rights. They wear what they want. There are no women transvestites by society's definition. Yeah, because...
Well, I dress kind of butch, so...
You just wear what you want. Women have total clothing rights. And so do men, if they want to have it. So I just wear what I want. Like, I'm wearing trousers now. And people say, oh, why aren't you wearing a dress? Well, I don't have to wear it all the time. It's like, women, you don't have to wear trousers. You don't have to wear a dress. I just wear what the hell I want. If anyone's got a problem with it, they can stuff it.
But I mean, you know, what... I mean, I'm not asking... Iron.
The skirts weren't. Well, there was a covering of top.
Do you wear a dress? I mean, do you wear dresses?
I wear whatever. I wear dresses, I wear skirts, I wear trousers.
What do you feel like in them, then?
I feel like me.
You need to feel more female, you know what I mean? Not feminine, I mean female. Like, you need to feel more lightweight rather than men always seem
to be... If you try and define masculinity and femininity, you really get lost, because a lot of it, I think, is adopted. If you take it up to puberty, girls and boys are very similar.
Yeah.
After that, there's a lot of adopted things. I remember taking a lot of masculine adopt, especially the walking and stance and sitting around like this. You sit around like this, kids at school are less likely to give you a hard time than if you sit around like this. But these, both the campness and macho, they're both adopted things.
Well, sometimes you paint your nails. And does that make you feel more like...
Well, you see, I'd be quite happy to be a woman, but I am not.
You like...
Biologically.
Yeah.
Biologically, I am very masculine. I believe it's genetic chromosomes, it's inbuilt. I mean, I didn't choose it for, say, hey, transvestite sounds like a good idea.
We always think of transvestites, the guys who, like, have to be Barbara Streisand. You think, what happened in that childhood that this guy has to dress like such an ugly woman?
Well,
a beautiful nose.
Couple of points here. There's two, because if you are repressed TVs, you feel they can't wear skirts or, you know, anything, dresses, whatever, at any point.
Yeah.
If you suddenly think, all right, I'm going out to some sort of ball and I'm going to really dress up or whatever, they will go the whole hog, really extreme, which a lot of women have a problem with because they feel it's representing an extreme image of women, and they have a big problem with this. But that's because all these male TVs are repressed. Women now can wear what the hell they want, total thing, and so they're much more at ease of saying, I'm going to wear Doc Martens, but I'm going to wear a skirt as well. And they mix and match all over the place. And also men, they have to have a lot of guts to go into shops which have a lot of women's clothing and say, right, I'm going to try on this dress and say, what do you think? You know, and I do that. I try and push to do that. But you've just got to get a lot of guts, because people tend to stare at you with eyes like, and you need to just say, what? I'm buying a dress. Is there a big problem? And they want to sell their dresses, so in the end they go, my big thing I worked out was, if I don't have a problem with it, other people don't seem to have a problem with it.
That's right.
And I told my dad, he was very groovy. It took me 6 years to tell my dad. I told my dad, I said, after a football match,
good timing.
Like you do. Yeah.
So he said, Dad?
Yeah, I said, Dad, I'm a transvestite. And he said, he went, all right.
He looked it up.
No, he was just extremely cool about it. He's a very cool dad. And then that wasn't the reaction I was expecting. I was expecting anything other. I had a million different reactions he could have done, but he just went, yeah, okay.
He said when you went into, like, newsstands and stuff, and the guy, you know, there's a moment where you both clock your nails.
Well, no, if I'm wearing makeup, it's this idea of, there's the fear thing. Well, there's a fear thing that I have, if you're coming out gay, lesbian TV, you do have this fear thing of people hassling you. But these people are just scared people as well. People just shout the street, oi, hey! And they're just tragic people. They all hang out in groups of five, and it seems to be because they have a fifth of a personality each, and so they do that. It does seem to work like that. You know, he's never got a lone shouter on his own. You're standing at the street, going, oi! Oh, I'm on my own. Oh, dear. you know, so that doesn't happen. But going in a... into... I sometimes see people, they just freeze up because they don't see many blokes in makeup. And I go into... and I've worked this out. I go into somebody, you know, a news agent, and I just see them look at me, and they go, oh, ah. And they see me, bloke wearing makeup, and the image goes into the brain, and the brain goes, no information on this. no information. And I can see the signal just going all around the brain. No information. Not a clue how to react in this situation. And then they start doing weird things, like, get the toffee crisps out the back. Go on, get the toffee crisps. Sellotape all the newspapers together. And I can just see them sort of melting in front of me. And as soon as that happens, I just got to say very quickly, I want a packet of crisps. And then they go, what, you eat crisps? How weird. You know, it's just because they're not used to it. But if they see a woman coming wearing trousers and Doc Martens and short hair and no makeup and a bloke's jacket on, they'll go, hello.
And they'll say, tape up the newspapers.
No, they're just kidding me.
Okay, now I'm going to just jump away from you. Is that okay?
That's all right.
I'm sad, but you have to go now.
Yeah, it's okay.
Eddie, please, come back anytime. Sit on my sofa. I have my children. Okay.
I am never, ever coming back.
Ever. As long as you live.
It has been fun, but
it's
tedious.
Over. Difficult, I think.
Yes.
Yes. I've given you nothing. I haven't given you an inch.
Sex was great, though.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's all. Okay, that's Eddie. Now we go to somebody else. There's my segue. They're going downhill. I had to actually go to her because she couldn't be bothered to come to me. Her mother is Debbie Reynolds. Her father is Eddie Fisher. Her stepmother is Elizabeth Taylor. So that's who she is. She started off her life as Princess Leia. Then she dropped the princess and picked up the pen, and she lived there ever since. She is, among everything else, a leading expert on relationships. Now we will go to Carrie Fisher. Okay, what's the time now?
The time now is 2:15.
2:15. And we were here since?
Well, I've been here since 10:15.
10:15, waiting for Carrie Fisher. A lot of you may wonder, who is Carrie Fisher? As are we all. But whoever she is, she's made us wait here for 4 hours. It's a peeved look. All I can say is, she better be funny while she's out. They say she's off drugs, and we can only hope. Fingers crossed. Anything could come through that door. Well, let's show the books, and maybe that's as good as having her on the show. Here, you pretend you're Carrie Fisher, and I'll pretend I'm Carrie Fisher's friend. Hi, Carrie.
Hello.
I really like your book.
Thank you.
Did it take long to write?
No.
That's been very interesting. Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Look, pretend I'm Carrie Fisher. Pretend I'm Carrie Fisher. Come on, ask me some questions.
Are you off the drugs now?
Off the drugs, completely off the drugs. Once in a while, I wake up, and I'm not sure if I'm in the right room, but otherwise, I'm perfectly fine. Is she coming? Recognize her?
It isn't my first B12 shot. It is, as a mother, which you would think it would be a better, hello, I'm Princess Leia Organa. Fly me to Alderaan.
Do you know who she is? Be honest.
No.
No. What do you think she does for a living?
Thank you. Is that
Food fight! What does she do, do you think? And why are we filming
it? Why are people talking to me? She's a high fashion model.
Wait. High fashion model?
It used to be, but she had a horrible accident.
Horrible.
But you were an actress, and that was further than I got. I don't know
you
how good
be?
Or bad. I'm desperate. We discussed
yeah,
well,
try
this yesterday.
Saying Governor Tarkin.
You
I
got
thought
into
I
Central School of Drama.
Stench. Yeah.
Do you want to say why or you don't want to mention it? It was an endearing suit. She got into Central, and this isn't funny, because...
You can't do
no,
it.
You can't do it. I can't do it. I can... Look, if I cut the bit out where I laughed.
No.
The reason this girl got into Central School of Drama
speech
was because
drama.
Speech and drama, which I could not get into, though I auditioned twice, and I think was pretty good, was because they took, like, 12 people, and the 12th person... Two people. Two Americans. And one American died. I'm not smiling. And so she got in, unfortunately, and she got in.
She had an epileptic fit in a bathtub.
Right.
So don't want this.
No, don't upset this woman. Just she'll be a voice.
She'll be upset anyway, though. She has an upset energetic that finally results in a pleasantness. My daughter watches TV and she sees people she knows, so now she expects everyone she knows to be on TV. They put an ad. So Meryl's on in the upcoming thing of what's the movie?
Schindler's List.
No, you
House of the Spirit.
House of the Spirit.
Schindler's List, that's not funny.
Okay. So, no, but the next thing is, so they put an advert on for Schindler's List, and my daughter says, Hannah! That's funny. It was just a dark-haired woman running for a bad train. A train you wouldn't run for, say. You would run away from that train. Only she figured, Hannah!
But it's a compliment.
Just everyone that she knows is now on TV. But I just love that she was in Schindler's List, which means that she has an eye for the tribe. But she didn't say, like, grandpa or anything.
No, but you look like a kind of Schindler person.
I know, and
she is a Schindler person.
21 months knew that.
Then pull your hair back. Let's
and run for the train. Do the running for the train thing.
Did you call Liz Taylor like mom?
Oh yeah, I still do. Yeah, she adores me, drags me up onto her lap. What happened today, darling? How is the book doing? She adores me. No. No, I met her once when I was about 3. I went to the Beverly Hills Hotel with my father, and what I remember was she was wearing like a see-through negligee when she answered the door. And I remember it, so I must have known it was very important, and this was the clue to what had happened that had gone wrong.
And did your mother, was she kind of, what was she then? Was she as angry?
She's not angry. I'm on her behalf. But my mother was never upset. She was always like a fan of Elizabeth Taylor.
She thought, well, if you're going to be left for somebody,
might as well be Elizabeth Taylor. And that is really probably the truth.
That's her ego wasn't damaged, I'm sure.
Oh, it was. It was. Because Elizabeth was a friend, and it was a very public humiliation, and she wanted to die. And she had 2 small infants, and you cannot have the luxury of being depressed. I know this now, too.
Well, you got Paul Simon, which...
And I wrote all those lyrics. God, we're...
You wrote Bridge Over River Kwai?
Yeah. Bridge Over Debbie's Daughter, I think it was. But he changed it. I said, you're a fool. It's really catchy. Like a... But he changed it.
What does he know?
Men.
I know.
Go figure.
But he must have been fun. He doesn't
he
look
is fun,
fun. But he looks like maybe
well,
when the
I
doors
mean,
are
not
shut.
Like a consistent... But no men are.
And did you laugh at his jokes in the beginning?
Oh, that's how I got him.
Really?
I bet. Screamed with laughter.
I bet. And then
stupid.
When did like the stretch
no,
marks
no,
in your
no,
face?
No, no, no. So when he makes fun of being incredibly serious,
yeah.
It is funny, funny, funny. And the funniest person drunk in the world, period.
Really?
Pouring wine on animals. You know, that's funny to me.
Yeah, but you know, I've been with men where you think it's impossible to get this guy to laugh, and suddenly when, you know, there's something
oh, that's
to
the
life.
Big thrill. But
yes.
I mean, Harrison is the more extreme boring. Version of that, where you think, he's never going to smile. He is never, literally, there's going to be, his teeth are going to hyperventilate. I can't believe it. And then it happens, and it's like a miracle. It's like the virgin birth of his teeth. And you get so excited that you accomplished making him laugh. So, yes.
But then a lot of times when you get yourself in those situations, you're the kind of like tap dancer, you know what I mean? And that is your mission.
I was the one
and then you
that
hate
was
yourself.
Practicing wise, knowing looks in the stone grass of their periphery. You know what I mean? They would be like, and I would be looking like I was deliberately not caring that we weren't talking at all. I was like the dead air queen, you know, like captive by dead air. Contained by it. It's too quiet. I'm supposed to be making a point, but none existed. I acted like somebody like, how could you leave me? I'm so much fun. And like, who wants to have fun all the time, though?
I've been the tap dancer.
They
all
do
my
say
life.
I want you forever, and then they go, oh, but I mean, forever just ended. You know, I want, now I'm, oh, I should have had a V8. Now I want something calmer. I want to be the center. I don't want to be Carrie Fisher's boyfriend.
Right,
I don't
okay.
want to be Ruby Wax's sidekick.
Shut up, my husband's listening to this.
Well, but I mean,
yeah.
If you achieve a certain celebrity, you want to date an accomplished woman, you might not want to marry one. Because you don't want to be Miss, you know.
But between you
my
and
My mother's
Simon,
husband.
I'd say there's not much
right.
competition, so what was the problem?
He's definitely Mr. Carrie Fisher. Yeah. What? Does she want to be on the show?
No, I don't want to stop your private life.
God forbid.
Hello? Is this a Melissa that I didn't know?
Yeah, you know Melissa. We
I do. I got the
wrong
person.
No, you this, like her.
I know. I like her.
You
she's
are on, say hi really, really
yeah.
loud.
I thought it was nice.
There, you're on a show.
She has a friend.
I have a friend
has
in
a friend.
England.
Who likes
gives
her.
Gives me a party, and she says she likes
she has
me.
A party, and I didn't get invited.
You are invited. She
Melissa?
Wanted me to invite you.
Hi, it's Ruby.
It just happened. Look.
You.
We're
look
filming
at this room.
This
I'd love to come over later.
Don't, oh, good. Do you know who I am? You know who Eddie Fisher is? Who's Eddie Fisher?
Ordering and doesn't
see, he doesn't know who I am, but he knows I was
right,
in a
I'll
film.
See you tonight.
Bye-bye. I'm invited to a party.
See, that's what's good about interviewing me.
What were we talking about? Oh, men.
Oh, what a shock.
No, we were...
This is for your child, not for you.
Is it really? Yeah. I love these.
Isn't it? It's my present to your child.
I'm
I know
so
she's
happy.
Too young to appreciate
no,
it.
She isn't. She's seen one in the store,
but
sort of.
It's never too young to think things with batteries can make you happier than individuals. I couldn't agree with you more. It's the early learning training.
Look at you.
See, that's the first time I've seen you smile today.
Would
much,
you want
right?
him?
I'm not
can't
relaxing.
Believe it's your social life again. Hello? Miss Fisher's room.
Not really, she's in a cheaper room. But she'd like to pretend this is her room.
And there's another one that's in the book, The Beginning of Delusions of Grandma, that's really good. It was something about your girlfriend said, or somebody said.
We were going to all these like self-help, hilarity, est, blah, blah. And we were at the est 6 day, which is this incredibly intense, hello. And they do a sex night there, which is like, you want to shoot yourself. If you have to stand up in all these categories, like if you've ever thought of having sex with your, there was one girl that stood up
with
in
your what?
Zero.
You tell me you
your mother,
tell me.
Your father, oh, your right. brother, your friend, your blah.
So
your
you have
pet.
To stand up.
You have to stand up and sort of, if you ever have done these things, if you've ever done, put your hand inside a donkey and wave to his nose, you know. So it was everything you could possibly think of, right?
You had to raise your hand.
There was one chick that didn't stand up for anything. Played with yourself. I mean, I started to feel guilty and stood up in categories that I didn't belong in. Because there were people standing up for things you couldn't believe.
You watched this at an ESC meeting?
So we watched this. It goes on and on and on. Here's what they did. If you got too tired, you had to stand at the side of the room holding a log, which would drop on your head if you fell asleep. I got up on the stage and they said to me, so what's your deal? What's your problem or whatever? And I went all around it and it was drugs. I was like 24 then.
Right.
And I'm standing in front of 100 people. And so finally they said, what is your problem? And they show me the sheet where I put down, I would like to stop taking painkillers for no reason.
Right.
And I went, oh! I got off the stage and I felt like my skin had been removed. And they said,
well, you know, part of it is standing in front of 100 people because it's like the...
It is.
That's
the
why
process
you write too.
Of saying, I'm an alcoholic.
The process of writing it, too.
Yes.
The
yes.
poison leaves you.
Yes.
It's over.
As said, soon as I've written this book, it's no longer true
right.
of me.
I can
so
imagine.
It always makes me laugh when people say, are they autobiographical? Not anymore.
Right. Somebody else.
But they were history. At the time.
That girl on the cover.
If I'm able to say it and name it, it is no longer so, precisely. If I can observe it, I no longer have to be it. I'm
but that's
free
brilliant.
To be something else also. I didn't know it. It's the power of journaling.
Yeah.
But the danger is that when you're writing it, it slimes you. Like you say,
yeah.
the pages are sticky and your life becomes what, then you become this character.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah.
So I get stolen for the period of time that I'm writing the book and I don't write that fast.
Right.
The first one, yes. The next one's no. And as I see, I was writing the second book and I was with Paul.
Right.
And I said to him at one point, these people can't end up together.
Ooh, and so the book starts to have a life
make
just
it,
as strong
it
as
it
yours.
Sucks.
What can a man possibly give you? I mean, it's, and I'm not saying
peace
you.
Peace of mind.
You think that's
not
the,
peace
because
of
the
mind.
Rest of the world.
My mind is not his province. Peace of life. Do you know what I mean?
You just want to be.
I want to be allowed to be who I am without it getting up your goddamn nose. His. And you are permitted, and who am I to even permit you? Be who you please.
Right.
I want a very affectionate roommate. I don't want to be possessed. I don't want to be judged, criticized. I don't want to be as flawed as I've been with them. I don't want to be found
well, why can't you marry
them?
Your best friend?
Hannah, will you marry me?
I know, darling.
Seriously.
We've been trying. Well, the
I don't mean with a woman, okay? You know,
I'd like to.
Mary, you have men friends.
My mother was in a movie called Susan Slept Here, and in it, it's with William Powell, Dick Powell, and he, I wish it was William Powell, and he, at one point, she goes to kiss him, and she goes, and he kisses her on the forehead, and it was my first sense of humiliation.
Oh.
I looked over my shoulder to see if anyone else had seen that my mother had just been, in effect, rejected, because she
that's
was
a great
stupid
image.
Little ingenue, and I must have been 3 or 4.
And that stuck
What's
with
the
you.
Eddie story?
Well, the Eddie story is the only other person I've ever told this to, and I swear to God, is my therapist. Because it's my,
wow.
you know, seriously, it's not what he did. This is your father,
it's
Eddie
what he
Fisher.
Didn't do.
It's what he didn't do.
I knew it!
No, no, wait,
the
listen.
Story of his life.
I'm in Vegas. My father took me there when I was about 6, and I was a really ugly child. I had, like, bad teeth, you know, those, like, kind of the missing link thing. And I had my Shirley Temple doll with me. So we're at the Dunes Hotel, and my father says, there's Eddie Fisher. And he was sitting with some cronies of his. And my father went over to Eddie Fisher and said, hey, have I got a girl for you? Hey, Ruby, come on out here. Come on out here. And I was hiding behind the thing. He went, she's beautiful. And your dad started to go, yeah, let's see her. And my father, I think it might have been 10 seconds, but to me it was like 8 years went by going, boy, she's a knockout. He was with Liz
Taylor
at the time.
How old were you, six?
Maybe eight. He's a knockout. You got to see this chick. Come on out here, Ruby. And I wouldn't come out. And my mother went behind me and went, go on out there, Ruby. And I went out. And Eddie Fisher and his friends went, ha, 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 ha.
Oh, my God.
It wasn't cruel of your father. You know what I mean? It wasn't like...
You know what? It was cruel of all the adults.
It was cruel of my dad.
No, it was cruel of every adult in that
room. Isn't that horrible?
All right, we're going shopping now.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I don't want to get lipstick on your face.
I knew it.